Beloved Muslims, dear brothers and sisters, let us examine this gathering, the gathering of Jumu'ah. And let us have a closer look at Jama'ah congregations in general. Dear brothers and sisters, this is a very unique gathering. We pray together, we stand in organized ranks, we bow down together, we prostrate together, we follow one Imam. It is an organization that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has laid down. Dear brothers and sisters, do you see the communal and the social dimension of this ibadah? Do you realize how this ibadah enhances the spirit of community, solidarity, and the unity between the Muslims? Take another example of another ibadah, fasting. Muslims, they start fasting from the same time, from the dawn time. They break their fast at Maghrib. They share the feeling of hunger and thirst together. And there are many aspects of unity in this ibadah. However, does this draw your attention? Do you see the communal and the social dimension of this ibadah? Do you see how this ibadah enhances the spirit of community, solidarity, and unity between the Muslims? Zakah is a third example. It is a financial commitment towards a segment of our community, a segment that exists in any community. And it is a ibadah that displays the care and the compassion of the affluent people towards the needy people. It is an ibadah that brings the heart of the people together and remove any possible hardship, any possible resentment from the hearts of the poor towards the rich people. Do you notice this aspect of this ibadah that is part of our deen? Dear brothers and sisters, we can go on and on and speak about different aspects of the unity building nature of this deen. However, the most important question is, whatever happened to the spirit that must exist between the Muslims? The spirit of unity, the spirit of brotherhood, the spirit of togetherness, the spirit of solidarity, the spirit of one body. Whatever happened to this spirit that must exist in the Muslim community? Dear brothers and sisters, let us examine another aspect of this deen. Have you ever wondered why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prohibited backbiting or slandering? There is a reason, and the reason is obvious. The wisdom is there. You can see it. Because such an act promotes hostility, hatred, instills conflict between the believers, and may eventually lead to disunity between the Muslims, scatter the ranks of the Muslims. Have you ever why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prohibited belittling people, looking down upon people, insulting them, and quarreling with them? Because it is an evil spirit that may instill hatred and animosity between the believers and eventually lead them to be divided and disunited. same thing say about spying on Muslims, judging judging Muslims based on guesswork and suspicion. All of these things are prohibited because they instill hatred, animosity, and leads to disunity and the fragmentation of the Muslim community. On the other hand, we find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has encouraged good manners and certain qualities that bring the hearts of the people together. Starting from the time you meet your brother, when you greet him, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِهِ لَن تَدْخُلُ الْجَنَّةَ حَتَّى تُؤْمِنُوا وَلَن تُؤْمِنُوا حَتَّى تَحَابُّوا أَفَلَا أَدُلُّكُمْ عَلَى شَيْءٍ إِذَا فَعَلْتُمُوهُ تَحَابَبْتُمْ أَفْشُوا السَّلَامَ بَيْنَكُمْ. By Allah, you will never enter paradise until you believe, and you will never believe until you love one another. Should I tell you about something, a tool by which you would develop love for one another? Afshu salama baynakum, spread the greeting by assalamu alaykum between you. This is the key. Just that assalamu alaykum is our gate to paradise. It brings the hearts of the people together. A smile that we put on our face when we meet our brother is an act of charity. As Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, تَبَسُّمُكَ فِي وَجْهِ أَخِيكَ صَدَقًا. The smile that you have at the face of your brother is an act of charity. Meeting your brother in Islam, and for the sister to meet her sister in Islam with a smile, cheerful, is an act of charity for which we are going to be rewarded. Why? Because it brings people together and enhances the bond of brotherhood and the love for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Dear brothers and sisters, I'm bringing this aspect of this deen before you today, because we are in most need for this Muslim unity, and the price that we pay for our disunity is very, very high. Dear brothers and sisters, we come to this country, we bring with us many differences that to this land. Many differences that are not applicable even to this land. And we maintain this state of disunity in this land, and this is causing us to pay a high price, very high price. I am addressing this subject today because I have a message for you. Yesterday I attended a meeting that included 60 imams, and we heard directly from the imams who were removed from the airplane, and they were insulted, disrespected, and detained for several hours. Then they were released when the US Airways notified the authorities on them for no reason whatsoever. We heard in the news that they were playing on the airplane. False. They were playing in the terminal while they were waiting for their flight, which is something that is not very normal. That's something that is done by more than 1 billion Muslims. We heard that they refused to heed to the instruction of the crew, which is false, because they did not know what's going on in the airplane. They did not have any idea, and the crew, according to them, was helping them buckling their seat belts when they saw the police coming inside. They went out of the airplane handcuffed, and they were told, "You are not under arrest." But Why? Because they were Muslims. They were targeted just because they were Muslims. There is no other reasons for this. They were cleared. And even after they were cleared, the US Airways refused to give them another, to book them in another flight. Why? Imagine, dear brothers and sisters, if because of an incident like this, all the Muslims in the United States stand united and say, we cannot take this anymore. We will not allow anybody to infringe on our civil rights. And we do not accept to be treated but as any other American citizen is treated. Would people do this to the Muslims? This is a price that we pay for our disunity. And there is a need for us to realize this. We are staying in this country. So we have to stay with our dignity. And we should not accept that our rights be violated as American citizens of this country. This is a reminder for us. If you think you are fine because you personally is not targeted, this is not good news, dear brothers and sisters. If you say, oh, now they are targeting Hanafis and I am not Hanafi. Oh, they are now targeting Shafis and I am not Shafi. They are targeting Pakistanis and I am Arab, alhamdulillah. Oh, they are targeting Indians and I am okay. This feeling is problematic because a time will come when we will not find anybody to speak or to say anything. And this reminds me of a very interesting and beautiful quote from Pastor Martin Niemöller of Nazi Germany. He said, and this is, you need to go back in time and put yourself in that time frame. He said, first they came to the communist, and I did not speak up because I wasn't a communist. Then they came for the Jews, and I did not speak up because I wasn't a Jew. Then they came for the trade unionists, and I did not speak up because I was not a trade unionist. Then they came for the Catholics, but I was a Protestant, so I did not speak up. Then they came for me, but at that time no one was left to speak up. So if we are to say, alhamdulillah, I am businessman, my business now is not targeted, it is not politically correct that I help my Muslim brothers and sisters, then at one time we will find ourselves very weak in this country. And therefore, dear brothers and sisters, we have to pursue our civil rights. We have to stand together. We have to be one position, especially in these matters. If a Muslim individual or a Muslim organization was targeted just because of their Islam, not because of a criminal activity, not because of their violation of the laws, not because of a mistake that they committed. If they were targeted because of their Islam, then it is incumbent, it is an obligation upon all of us to stand united and support each other. This is a religious obligation. When it comes to the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the matter is not expressed in indirect indication. Please come forward, allow the standing brothers to sit down, inshallah. So the matter of supporting one another and uniting as a Muslim community is not left just in the book of Quran and the Sunnah. It is not expressed in hints only. Rather, dear brothers and sisters, this is, as I said, it is a religious obligation. It is a, there are clear-cut commands from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for us to be with one another and to support one another and to honor one another and stand in defense of one another. There are clear-cut prohibitions that we abandon one another and fail one another and forsake each other. And this is not a matter of difference between the scholars. So it's all our imams who agree on this issue that Muslims should stand united and should be together and speak in one voice and stand in defense of each other. Dear brothers and sisters, I'm saying this because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, وَالْمُؤْمِنُونَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتُ بَعْضُهُمْ أَوْلِيَاءُ بَعْضٍ. The believing men and the believing women are protective friends of one another, which means they honor one another, they defend one another, they protect one another, they respect one another, they are there for each other, and that this is part of their iman, which means it is a required characteristic of iman to love and defend and honor your Muslim brother. It is part. If we don't do that, then this is indicative of a flaw in our commitment to this deen, the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also said, وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا. And hold fast, all of you together, to the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and do not be divided. All of us know this ayah. If you enter to the homes of Muslims, you find it written in very beautiful calligraphy. It is there, all of us know this. But we, our reality shows that we have abandoned this ayah as though we believe that it is abrogated or not applicable anymore. This is part of the clear-cut commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah also said, وَلَا تَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ تَفَرَّقُوا وَاخْتَلَفُوا مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَهُمُ الْبَيِّنَاتِ وَأُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمْ عَذَابٌ عَظِيمٌ. Do not be like those people who fell into disputations and divided after clear proofs have come to them. And Allah also said, وَلَا تَنَازَعُوا فَتَفْشَلُوا وَتَذْهَبَ رِيحُكُمْ. Do not fall into disputations, otherwise you will fail and you will depart. You will fail. This is the price that we pay for not uniting, that we fail and we become weak. And therefore, since we have chosen to live in this country, we have to live with our dignity. We have to live and not accept that anybody infringe on our rights as Muslims. We should not accept any status less than any other American citizen in this country. And therefore, we all, if one sister was bothered because of al-hijab, all Muslims are sinful if they don't defend her and protect her. And this in the case of these imams, or the case of life organization, or other cases that we have in this community, all of us should stand together. And by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when it came to life, our brothers here in the executive committee, they contacted CARE immediately and they told him, here are our accounts, they are at your disposals, coordinate with other organizations, and we are ready to take out our accounts from these banks whenever you see fit, as an organization who is coordinating all these efforts between all Muslim organizations in the area. So this is good. And when it, in the case of the six imams also, CARE is taking the lead, and we should support this organization because they are filling or they are meeting one all the Islamic obligations in this land. Again, we have a major responsibility as Muslims who are living in this land, and that is to build our community, to build institutions, to build masajid, to build Islamic centers, to build schools. However, it is as important, dear brothers and sisters, that we protect these institutions and we preserve these institutions, and this cannot happen but by us being united and vigorously pursuing our civil rights and seeking truth and justice. And this is the basis. We said we should struggle, we should fight for our rights, but this struggle is non-violent, and it is a struggle that follows every legitimate means in order for us to enjoy equality when it comes to our rights as citizens in this land. Dear brothers and sisters, these imams are going to have, inshallah, a press conference on Monday in Washington, D.C., and they will go to the highest level in this matter, which is good, because this is will set a precedence, because we have the grounds for our rights in the Constitution, but we cannot really enjoy them but when we struggle in order to establish that we are equal in this land. We need to learn from the African American community. They enjoy now more rights than before, but still it was not an easy path. Rather, it was a path that was paved with hardships, with sacrifice, and with a lot of perseverance. We should not really just sit back and feel that the matter does not concern us. Again, we may build institutions, but what is the use of these institutions if they became empty buildings? Buildings in which there is no operation, no freedom to practice our religion, or to pursue the mission with which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has entrusted us. This is why, dear brothers and sisters, inshallah, we should pursue these issues that we have nowadays, and wait for the instructions. If there is an action that is needed from us as a community, then we should do, if care, and the other organizations, because there are more than one organization that involved in the case of life. If they decided that we take our money from Comerica, then all of us should do that. If they decided that we should not travel by US Air, we should all not travel by US Air. We should do that. This is the way that some people understand. When the pocket hurts, people feel the pain, right? And when some corporation hurts, then they feel the pain and they understand that they did something, they wronged the Muslims, and this may be for them as a way to go back and apologize for the Muslim community. If one person did it, he would do his responsibility before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the impact is in the unity. It's when all of us follow the instruction of our leadership, whether it is the leadership of the masjid or the political leadership, that's very important. And inshallah, we'll keep you posted on these issues.